Good evening and good evening to everybody. I welcome all of you back to our sessions for tonight. Tonight, we are going to continue a session that is also very mind-blowing on anger management. My dear brother, my dear sister, as we welcome ourselves, we want to say a very good evening to everybody who is on the line, including our brothers and sisters who are yet to join us. Shall we pray for ourselves and for those who are yet to join us? We would all pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God, our Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the gift of life. Lord, you have created us and we are wonderfully made. Many a times, O God, we fail to understand our very selves created in your own image. Teach us, O God, by these sessions today, that we will come closer unto knowledge of ourselves, especially in the area of our anger. Lord, teach us to trust and know that with you, all things are possible. Father, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and teach us to be serious with our Christian life, that being born again may not be a question of church, but will be a question of life that give glory unto your name. For you are Lord and you are God and you love us. We thank you for gathering us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So with these words, we are welcome once again to today's session, the session on anger management. Anger management, it's very, very important that we understand what we are up to today. Last week, we had the opportunity to look at a few things. We were able to look at facts about anger. We had some facts about anger. Then we went on, why do I need anger management? Everybody needs anger management. Yes, it is easy to say it, but very few of us accept it. Then we looked at what is anger? What is anger? That kind of emotion when we express as a result of our interpretation of a situation. And because of that, we do things usually negative, but not all anger is negative. Then we look at a man called Godfrey Chapman in his book and how he was able to help us understand that God's nature, his essence is not about anger, but the very fact of his love and the very fact of his holiness brings in his justice and his anger. So we also understand the side of God that deals with what anger. And then we look at Jesus, who was angry, not once, not twice, but at least four times. At least we look at these. And we were able to identify that in all of the times when Jesus was angry, he managed to control his anger such that his anger brought good and not just bad. Then we ended up in the areas of our lives where anger rules us, So today, and then I want to say that it is necessary that I state this right at the beginning. These sessions are not to solve our problems right now, but rather to help us know or accept that we have need for anger management. In most cases, you may need to seek help. For most of us, when we have anger management problem, there will be the need for us to be able to seek help. I hear some of our brothers or sisters are not able to hear. I don't know how we'll be able to help them at this time, because if I even give an instruction, they may not hear. But if you are nearby, anybody who is not hearing, sometimes it's just a tap on the screen, and you slide to the right, then you are able to find the sound button. But otherwise, I go on with the teaching, anger management. So my dear brothers and sisters, many of us need help. Adofo wo Kristo mo ade a yesua ye eye ebufu ohyew a ewo ye mu bebre so na se bufu ewo wo so a ye be ni den onipa biara niwa ebufu eni ni mu eni tie hu ebufu hu asem bebre ye hye se obia ehia se ne bufu obeye den obetu na no dariga na ne bufu soso pato ne dariga sa eni ebisa se ne ebufu eni den obarima bi a fre no Godfrey Chapman ochre ye nse onyankopon wo hoyi nebufuo no efri ne do ene ne kronkron ye mu ene ti so ohu se nipa emfa ne kronkron ye ana ne do no enye den enye juma na nebufuo no aba se de ebe ye obetwe nipa e de aba ne do ene ne kronkron eye mu na ye hu se ye wo mia bia bebria e wo ya bra bom a ehia se ye be ye den ye yin ehia se Yebeti yehu edie efi ebufuo mu. I'm still having more text messages coming up. Please let me just help our people. Okay. So we try to look at now. Last week we were able to look at in which areas or situations of life do we need anger management? In which areas of our life do we need anger management? The first part is all those of us who are leaders, and many of us are leaders. Many of us are leaders. Look at Moses, spiritual leader, taking the people of Israel out of Egypt. Look at Adolf Hitler, a man who caused so much havoc to the world. Look at the man with the Bible in his hand. Moses had the Ten Commandments in his hand, and the man of God also has what? The Bible in the hand. And yet, many of us who are doing this, we are full of anger. Some of us are preaching and we are angry, and we use the word of God just to hit people like that. No. We must do it out of love. So if you are in any form of leadership, you need to know that anger management is necessary for you. Again, this is the area of marriage. Marriage. The picture to my left is about the man who thinks he's right. And the one to my right is dealing with the woman who thinks she's right. And the picture in the middle says, I am right, the man. And the woman says, me too, I am right. And this has generated anger in marriage. And if you care to know, most marriages are just characterized by anger that is brewing like a volcano that is about to explode. Not just in marriage, but also in the area of parenting. Parents shout and put their frustration on their children, and children go to school. Some of your children, they have started lying. Some of your children, they have started cheating. Some of your children, they have started stealing. You have to ask yourself, where are these things coming from? The way you just put all your anger on your children, that's what will happen to your children. Some of our children, they are not talking. Some of our children, they have become all of a sudden shy and everything. Where is it coming from? When anger in the family is not yet controlled. Then among siblings, there is always anger. I want it. I am better than you. Look at the young man in green. He's saying, "Osh, I wish that I am grown up. I want to be a man. I'm tired of being a young boy. I want to be grown." Many people want to be grown. People are struggling to be old. They want to be old all of a sudden. When even old men and old people are struggling to be young, the young are struggling to be old. Well, I don't know whether I am young or old, What I know is that I love being myself, and that is what is important. The man who is driving is having a sledgehammer in his hand and ready to hit somebody's head. This is what is happening every day on the road. Lots of us are bosses. People are bosses, and we like to rule it over everybody. And the way you talk to people shows that oftentimes you are just an angry soul. When we are working and things don't go well, we just hit the things, shout, and do everything. Look, those things, you have to be careful about them. If you are doing it in a way that is just venting just your anger in a godly manner, yes, that is good. But don't let people, don't put it out, don't take it out on people. That is not good. In football, in games and everything, this thing happened. Last week, I showed these things. Death, pandemic, lockdown, and things. Look at where the president says, let us stay at home. Then everybody is shouting. President says, let us be free. Then everybody is shouting. What do we want? My dear brothers, my dear sisters, we need to understand that human beings, we are full of anger. So we all need anger management. This is what will lead a lot of people or some of us into drinking, not just drinking one bottle or anything. That may be okay, but, you know, serious alcoholism. And then you solve all your problems by the bottle. You have to be careful. A lot of betrayals in marriage. Betrayals. You have a knife or a dagger at your back, ready to fight. Ready to fight. Look at this man, the way he's talking. Look at his face. Look at his facial muscles. Even the way he has just, the face. A lot of us, when you are talking to your wife and your children, or if you are talking to your priest or talking to people, you can't even smile. Oh, my brother, my sister, smile. Even as you are looking at me right now, smile. Yes, I may not see you, but just smile. It's just going to do you some good. It's anger management. It's anger management. Now, look at the picture that you see on your screen. This is a volcano that is erupted. The top of the volcano that has erupted is the anger that you see in people who are doing serial killing or mass murders. They are the people that we think are full of anger. But the truth is that within the volcano, there are anger fires. All of us, we are angry souls. And we need redemption. And what is funny is that many of us don't talk about these things. And we cry out in the name of Jesus. We pray nice prayers, but full of anger. Let somebody do something very small and you see. Look at people who are praying, for example. I use this example oftentimes. Somebody is praying in church. And then another person is passing, making noise. Instead of you to have the patience and respect for another soul and tell the person, oh, my dear brother, can you please keep quiet? You just shout at the person. Which fool is that? Who is that uncivilized person? You see, that shows the anger in you. Meanwhile, you are before your God. And afterwards, you do your face nice and say, oh, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Meanwhile, you have just insulted a soul. This is anger. Many of us, sometimes you insult your wife and then afterwards you pick the phone and you have just come to sit here. Some of you have just finished insulting people even before you came here. Now I'm speaking to you. You have to be careful. All of us, don't say that anger is the person who has caused mass murder or serial killing. You and I, all of us, we have anger within us that is brewing like a volcano. And if we do not take care, we are going to get into trouble very, very soon. How do I know that I may have anger management problems? I have established that everybody has anger. But sometimes, some of us, our anger is too much. So we need anger management. But how would I know that I need anger management? Number one. Trick number one or technique number one, when people tend to tiptoe around you, so who say nipa the bounce ya na ye che say ye banu wa 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 sa na che say who say ebufuo ewo mu san say wuni abotre nti ye papa numa ye wofie ye maami numa ye wofie teachers father fuo obiara so obi ba unchen. Yes, there are sometimes you have to be wild. But every time people are coming to you, they are tiptoeing. They are afraid. you know that it is a sign to let you know that you have an anger problem. Because otherwise, even though people have done wrong, you will find a godly way of correcting people and not just feel that, yes, they are wrong, so I just give it to them. In fact, you have a problem if you do that. You have a big problem. You need anger management and anger therapy to help you. So when you find people tiptoeing always around you, then you know that you may have an anger problem. Now, the next one is when you often find yourself regretting for things you have said or things you have done. You must be aware. Hey, sisiya na as wakwako kan sembi. Sisiya na wakwako yedeng. Wakwako ye bibibi. Wakwako kan sembi ana wakwako ye bibi. Na fe edi asemaba. Ususuwa, di tide biya udiye na wakwako fa asemaba. Anasa udi biya na wase wakopacho. Unipasa anu nimse ebufu ewa osu. When you always or too often you find yourself having said something that you could have just had a little bit of patience, then you know that you have an anger problem and you have to seek help. More than, number three, more than one person has mentioned to you that you have an anger problem. You are with your wife. Your wife tells you, your anger is not good. Your boss tells you, your children tell you, you have to be take this thing serious. People are telling you all feedback is feedback. Even if it's negative feedback, it is feedback. When people are telling you you have an anger problem, don't tell them that it is people who don't know. That is not right. The next one is that you feel that you are surrounded by idiots. What does it mean? There are so many people who always think that they can think for you. Whenever they talk to you, they say that you are they always think into your mind. And then don't allow you also to express your mind. When people do that, they have anger. It's a sign that you may have an anger problem. You feel you are surrounded by idiots. People don't understand. So you are the only one who can do it. Then you have a big problem. It's not idiots that are surrounding you, but you may be the one who is acting like one. The next one is that you always think that life is unfair. People who always think that life is unfair, they have anger problem, because it is true, life is unfair. But you have to make it always your focus. What about the good things in life? Why is it that you are never able to see good things in life? Why is it that you never talk about good things in life? Always the unfairness, the negative things, negative, negative, negative. People who are like that, they are called angry souls. They are called what? Angry souls. The next one is that you blame others for what's going on in your life. Anything negative is others. Anything positive is you. Hey, you never accept responsibility. You know, responsibility comes from two words, ability and response. It is responsibility, your ability to respond, your ability to accept. People who don't have ability to respond are irresponsible. And many of us who are angry are irresponsible, because when you allow your anger to dictate to you such that you never accept responsibility. So every time it is somebody's fault. Look into marriages. You will see that daddy is always like that. Mommy is always like that. There are some children who are always like that. It is among us pastors and priests. Look at some of our people in the government and those of our leaders on the TV. Some of them, some of us, never, never accept responsibility. The truth is that we have anger problem. The next one is that you find yourself yelling, shouting, often on top of your voice when there is no problem. When you are behaving like that, you know that, my dear brother, my dear sister, it's not because you live by the seashore like Peter the apostle, but probably it's because you have an anger problem and you just don't want us to see. The next one is that you feel frequent and intense surges of rage in you. You know, there are some of us, the slightest thing, you see your whole body shaking. Your body is shaking. Your skin has become red, or your blood is pumping. Your heart is pumping more blood. My brother, my sister, you have a problem. It is sickness, and this type of sickness can enter your spirit, can eat into your soul, and can affect your body if you don't deal with that. And above all, it can affect the people that you love. The next one is that your anger response are usually your anger response. Not sorry, it's not you, but your anger responses are usually hate. You can't forgive. You can't forget. My dear brother, be careful about that. You can't forgive. You can't forget. You always respond in anger with hate, the most violent way. Why? The fact that you are angry doesn't mean you have to break a bottle. The fact that you are angry doesn't mean you have to hit somebody to fall down. The fact that you are angry, do you have to slap your wife? Oh, of course, there are some women who beat their husbands. It is not often said, but I tell you, it is very, very true. We don't have to say it loud, but it is happening. They have anger problems, serious anger problems, but nobody wants to talk about it. The next one, you have been referred to anger management session by your spouse, at work, or by the court. Some of us, your anger is leading you to divorce. Some of us, your anger is making you lose your job. Some of us, you have gone to fight. Now the court says, be careful. If you have such a problem, you also need anger management. The last one is that you are searching for solution to this problem or have a particular interest in this topic, either for yourself or others. All of this, we need anger management. So we go on. Where do we start from? If you want to do anger management, then the first thing that you need to consider is that if I have to convince you today that all of us, and particularly you, need anger management, then this talk is not for you. I don't have to convince you any longer. You have to know that all of us have anger problems and we have to help ourselves. Number two, any Christian will truly be hurt and concerned if you discover that your actions hurt another person. Maybe you didn't know, but today we have come and we know that, yes, there's a lot of anger in us, and it is hurting our spouses. It is hurting our church members. A lot of societies are there. They are president problem, the members problem. Even among them, they are fighting so much. And what is the problem? Pride and anger is all that is eating us. No, true Christians, and I said true Christians, not those who just go to church, not those who just rush and go into communion, not those who just give fat collection, not those who are ready to just give tight but hate their brethren. No, true Christians are concerned when they know that their action hurts somebody. That one, they will be hurt. The solution to processing the need for anger management lies in your appreciation that you are a new creature in Christ. We are not to allow our flesh to rule us. My dear brothers, my dear sister, remember the quote that I said, anger is not free. It always comes at a cost. Anger is not free. It always comes at a cost. How do we interpret? Why is it that so many of us interpret things differently? You know, my dear brother, my dear sister, there were three people who were in a hotel. One was a widower, a widower. And then when they were in the hotel, they just heard that there was a big noise. The widow just shouted, "Ghost, ghost, ghost." Where is the ghost coming from? Because her husband is dead. The rich man started shouting, "Thief, thief, thief." Because the rich man thinks that if there is noise, somebody is coming to steal my money. Then there was a supposed Christian there. "In the name of Jesus, the devil is coming. I pray in the name of Jesus." You see, where is the problem? Because it is what is eating you, what is in your mind, that affects the way you interpret things. So what am I saying? I'm saying that when there is a problem, you have to take your time. Your childhood and upbringing affects the way you interpret issues. If in your home, nobody was talking, when you are with your wife and your wife is talking too much, you get angry. People are talking, you just get angry. Why? Your upbringing. Maybe in your home, people were just mirror at this. Your childhood. So, and you know that there are some people who never talk about their childhood. They never talk about their childhood and upbringing because they are afraid to go there. When they go home, they are afraid to talk about the things that they used to do. It is haunting them like a bad dream. Yes. Then we have past experiences. Maybe somebody did something to you, or you just remember it and then it just puts you off like that. Past experiences prevent us or pushes us into interpreting sometimes things wrongly. And because of that, we get angry that we are not supposed to get angry. Or we get angry that we could have taken our time. Another thing that affects our anger is that current situation. Look at these three women, these three people. The woman said, "Ghost, ghost, ghost." The other person says, "Thief, thief, thief." The other one says, "The devil, devil, devil." Your current situation. Maybe you don't have a child. So when we talk about anything about children, then you get angry. Maybe you don't have a husband. When we talk about a marriage, then you are angry. Maybe your marriage is in trouble. So when we talk about divorce, then it is a problem. Then you get angry. You see, the fact that you are in a current situation, that doesn't mean that you should get angry at certain situations. They say old ladies are always not at ease when dry bones are mentioned in a parable. So ask yourself, why do you get angry? Is it because you are an old lady? Is it because you have a problem? Admit the problem and deal with them. Sometimes too, the problem is your expectation. What you are expecting, you expect something. Another thing is your temperament. The way God created you. If, for example, you are a sanguine person, you always think that people should be around. So you interpret it that way. And when you don't get it that way, you just get angry. If you are choleric, you always think that I must have my way. If I can't have my way, then I have to get it by hook or crook, especially by crook. Temperament is ruling you. You need to act out your temperament in a godly way. Then the next one, and which is the most important, your level of openness to the things that are spiritual and worldly. So if you are spiritual and you are in Christ, you are able to accept your new life and the Holy Spirit can use you. If you are in the world, if you are full of darkness, you see that your life, your interpretation is always worldly and fleshy. So I ask you, what is your level? That is what we know. Now you see, the way you interpret things comes from these. The squirrel went to the counselor and told the counselor, "Counselor, I hear we are what we eat." The counselor said, "Yes, that is true, Mr. Squirrel." Then the squirrel said to the counselor, "Oh, counselor, I am nuts. I am nuts." Why? Because the squirrel eats nuts. So the squirrel has accepted that I am nuts because I eat nuts. It is true. What we eat determines what we are. Your childhood, your past experience, your current situation, your expectation, your temperament, and your level of spirituality will determine how you respond to anger. So all of us need what we call cognitive therapy. We need what we call cognitive therapy. You can find it in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, when St. Paul says that we must all be renewed, be transformed by the renewal of our mind. We must be what? Transformed by the renewal of our mind. Remember, the word transform comes from two words. Trans means move. Form means shape. So you have to get a new shape, and it must move out from the old one. So transform, that's it. It is a formation that moves away from the past. It is not just a formation, but a transformation. And our formation, which is moving, must be what? Must come as a result of the renewal of our mind. If you allow your mind to be renewed, what you eat, what you feed on, is what you become. So if you are a squirrel, then you know that you are nuts, because the squirrel feeds on nuts. So if you are always talking negative, 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 what will happen? Your anger is negative. If you are in the spirit, your anger is even spiritual. Look at Jesus's anger. It was a spiritual anger, and it was used for the good. So everybody needs what I call the cognitive therapy. In cognitive therapy, three things are important. The way you think affects the way you feel, and how you feel will determine what you do. Oftentimes, we are not able to make the difference. What you think. I think you are not honest. That is what you think. Is it a fact? Is it an assumption? Or is it a presumption? You see, sometimes you think something. It may not be a fact. It may be an assumption. An assumption is that you just assume boys are like this, therefore, or girls like to be pampered, therefore, or if a lady is crying, then she just wants my attention, so I won't mind her. And a presumption is an assumption that is wrong. An assumption that is wrong. So you presume that somebody is angry, or your wife is not talking to you, so you won't talk to her. Meanwhile, she's just tired. You see, presumption. If you read from Psalm 19, verse 13, it says, "From presumption, restrain your servant so that it will not rule me." So many of us, we assume. In tree, we says, "Na me dream say, na me dream say, na me dream say." You see something happen, you just say, I thought. Let me put it in a funny way. Please, next time, don't thought. Stop thoughting, if I can say that. Stop thoughting every time. I thought. When are you going to do things by fact? Take your time and do things right. Then you see, the way you think affects the way you feel. If, for example, you have a dream and you just wake up that somebody gave you something and it was bad, the moment you see that person, how do you feel towards that person? You feel fear. If you think that somebody has hurt you and you see the person, how do you feel? You feel pain and you feel hurt. But where is the hurt coming from? Maybe that person has not hurt you. Even if he has hurt you, is it that much? So that is the problem. So sometimes our pain, our fear, and our hurt is not justifiable. And because of what you think, and because of what you feel, you begin to do certain things that are not right. So you throw tantrums. You just behave like a small boy whose toy has just spoiled. Hey, like that. And you see big men behaving that way because the child in you has not been allowed to grow. Your thought pattern has not grown. And your feelings is always you need help. So you fight. You coil up. Somebody will say that, I won't talk again. I won't talk again. Some people are so aggressive. The way, the decision and your reaction. All these things are very, very. So cognitive therapy deals essentially with the way you think affects the way you feel. The way you feel affects what you do. So if you want to change what you do and how you do what you do, think differently. Think differently. Have you not heard the woman whose husband slapped her, and then somebody said, "Hey, is it your husband has slapped?" He says, "Oh, don't worry. Yeah, there was something here that she was." Then later on, you deal with the problem well. You see, the way you think affects the way you feel, and when you think right, you see that it is difficult for you to get hurt and pain and fear, then you are able to love. So many of you, you can't love again. You have been cheated. You have been hurt. Where is the problem? The hurt has finished. It is gone. But you are still living in the hurt. You are living in your past. So the thing has ended. It is in your head. So the pain is in your heart. And because of that, you can't talk to the person. Why are you killing yourself? Think different. Change your mind. Change your attitude. We must be transformed by the renewal of our mind. And we will feel differently. And when you feel differently, then you begin to sing that song. I feel good. Ba-na-na-na-na-na-na. Yes, so good. Because you think well, you feel well, you do well. That is what is good about anger management. So cognitive therapy is very good. Think well so you feel well. And if you feel well, you will do well. So that is one thing. Apart from cognitive therapy, direct cognitive therapy, there are other behavioral therapy that I may just want to bring to your attention. I have talked, the first thing is cognitive restructuring or reframing. That is what I just talked to you about. The second one is guided discovery. That one is sometimes you have an issue. You go to somebody. I think my wife is cheating. I think my husband is cheating. I think my husband or somebody is telling a lie. Go and narrate it to somebody, and the person will help you, guide you to discover that you only assumed wrongly. So your anger has no basis. So many times our anger has no basis. And even if you are angry, is that the way to act? Is that the way to act? So the next one is what? Exposure therapy. And what is the exposure therapy? That means that you, for example, we tell you, for example, in case you catch your wife cheating, what will you do? Me, I'll do this. Then you say, no, take your time. So now you are exposed to certain things. And then you begin to think about it. Next time anything happens, you see that your thinking and your behavior. So many of us, we don't even think about certain things. So we just act and you find out that you are sorry. A lot of us, we must be exposed. That is why sometimes we watch movies. That is why sometimes when you watch a movie, some good movies expose us to the realities on the ground. And when you do that, you see the king David and Nathan exposed David to what he was doing by telling him a story. And when David was angry, he says, you are the one. That is what is called exposure therapy. Another one that can help us is journaling and thought record. You know, some of us, the words that you speak, if you can write them down, some of us will say, me, never, never write it down. Write it down. After 3 days, you will see yourself doing the same thing. Me, this woman, I will eat her food again. Write it down. 3 days, when I call you, you will tell me, Father, I am eating. Then I'll ask you, whose food are you eating? Whose food are you eating? Me, never. You are lying. Journal, write it down. It's very, very important. Then activity scheduling. You know that there are certain things that are difficult to do. So if you don't know how to do it, maybe because you are afraid, you whenever you talk to your somebody, it becomes a fight. It's because you didn't plan it. So plan that today at this time, I'm going to talk to my wife. I'm going to talk to my son in this particular way. You plan it. You schedule it. So you give yourself time to relax about it. Don't just start. Because because there's you think that your husband came home late and you just give it to him, hey, straight left and right like that, it will bring what a problem. Then we have behavioral experiment is when some your certain behaviors are brought to your attention and you evaluate them. And we also have what we call the relaxation and stress reduction techniques. Hey, many of us, especially Africans, we don't like reducing stress. Go and walk and go to the cinema with your significant other. Yes, you won't do it. Go and sit somewhere and relax. Go and walk on the tree. Sit down and talk. Just relax. Listen to some cool music. Lie down in the bed quietly. Today, we don't even give relax. Even your eye needs to relax. Sometimes you see before you go to sleep, you are watching. Your eye is on the screen. So when you sleep, you see that the blue light has entered into your eyes. So even when you are sleeping, you are still seeing light like that. And many of us are not sleeping. And because you are not sleeping, anger de bi keke. Anger de be keke. You have to be careful about that. Role playing. What happens in role playing is that we try to do teamwork. If you want to be able to help yourself in anger management, you need to do role playing. You need to get into a team. You need to help yourself. There's even two people. Look at some people in church. They can never be with anybody. They always like to do it alone. Then there is a big problem. Then the last one is successive approximation. That is that all this therapy that I have said, all these things, it is difficult to just start it all once. So just say, today I'll do this, tomorrow I'll do that, the following day I'll do that. So just the whole work, cut them into pieces. And then, because nobody can change his or her life overnight, it's a lot of problem. My dear brother, if you read from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 23, Saint Paul tells us that human beings, we are spirit, we have a soul, and we are a body. Now as you look at this, you see the green part is the part that is the body. That is the outside part that we see. Then when you go inside a man or a woman, then you have the soul which deals with your personality. Then you go to the spirit which is inside you. It is inside you which gives you, it is the core of your being. Now when we are angry, anger is in the area of the soul, which is in the area of our emotions. When our emotions are affected, when your thinking is affected, when your will is affected. So you see that anger is a soulish problem. It is a thing that affects us, the way you think, the way you feel, and your choices, and it affects the soul. So that is what will affect us. So if we want to help ourselves, then my dear brother, I will say that check your spirit. Because if you have a good spirit, if you are in the Lord, if you submit to God, your soul will be free. The way you think will be pure. And your emotions will be soft. And what you do will be full of what? Good things. And then even your body, your five senses, your nerves, your brains, and all your organs will now continue to function well. Because of anger, there's so much pressure. There's so much stress. There's so much, a lot of sickness in our society. Now I want to end by saying that we can control ourselves if we want to. You can control yourself if we want to. There is a man who was the 100 meters champion in the 1980s. At those times, he was the greatest that ever lived. His name is Carl Lewis. Carl Lewis was able to practice the art of self-control such that even when he was finishing the 100 meters, his face muscle was relaxed as much as possible. So many of us, we have our facial muscle so wrinkled, and because of that, we are growing old before we are old. Too bad. Look at young boys and girls, men and women. We are just growing old. We are growing gray too early because anger, the big keke in us. So now, what is necessary in us? What can we do? Let us look at Carl Lewis, who is able. He's doing the 100 meters. Look at his facial muscle. Doing the 100 meters. That is just something to tell us. 100 meters, so difficult. And yet, this man has a good facial muscle. We are also running 100 meters. We are running the race of life. But you will not win merely with a squeeze or with a face pulled like that. Relax, my sister. Relax, my brother. Life must be approached like that. These are what we have learned today. I shall now open the phone lines and take some questions that will help us. And by that, we are bringing our teaching on anger management to an end today. If there are questions, I may now take questions on your anger management or things that I have said that demands attention. Somebody is asking a question. Please, Father, can we get the slides? If you want to get the slides, you may go to YouTube and watch the whole thing. You will find on YouTube, you can find the whole recorded version. Later on, it will be uploaded onto YouTube. Okay. Somebody says to us, I have been listening from Kenya. God bless you from listening from Kenya for us. Yes. Any question, please? If you want to ask a question, you may put your hand up and one of the co-hosts will allow you to speak. So a person will be a questioner. Utumi Emma Unsasu, Uma Unsasua. Anybody with a question is allowed. Otherwise, you may write it for us. You may write your question so that we may share. You may bring your questions now if they are. The last time I was told that the questions only delayed, so I'm only giving a little bit time now in case the questions have been asked. And okay, there is a hand up. There is a hand up. Please, you'll be unmuted and then unmute the person.
Yes, Father, good evening. Yes.
Good evening, please.
Yes, I have this anger problem. I don't know whether I came in late, but I didn't hear how I can manage it, how to manage the anger.
Oh, wow, okay. How to manage your anger. It was the very last thing. Did you follow the last thing that we did? I don't know when you came in.
About 15 minutes ago.
About 15 minutes ago, we had been looking at, I've just projected something on the screen. Okay. Something on the screen. 9 points. Cognitive risk restructuring, guided discovery, exposure therapy, journaling, activity scheduling, and all these things. If you practice any of these, it is going to help you because it helps you, for example, guided discovery. Oftentimes we get angry because of our thinking. So in this case, when you discuss the problem with somebody, the person may help you see that the way you are seeing things is not the way you have to see things. So because of that, you learn to let down your guard a little bit so you don't get angry often. I hope that is okay. Those are the things that I explained. All these 9 points are ways by which we can manage our anger. And then also role play in successive approximation and things like that. Yes, okay. Is there any other hand up? If there's a hand up, you may please unmute the person. Another person says, thank you, Father. I am listening and watching from Boko. It's been great. God bless you. God bless you. Another says, there are those who do not really speak out. I don't get it. Okay. Okay, the questions, yes. Is there any other hand up? Yes, please. Ask your question, please. Who is speaking, please? If you put your hand up, you have been unmuted.
Okay.
Yes, please talk.
Okay, please, my name is Alphonse. I'm voting from Ghana.
Okay.
If you're in a relationship and then your partner always gets angry, but she doesn't recognize it, that she's been angry, and then you are trying to correct the person, but it's not getting it, how do you do?
Okay. First of all, you see, it is very difficult to drink medicine for somebody. So we have to expose the person, that is called the exposure therapy. We have to help the person to know the danger of what is happening. For example, this session that I am having, I am not having counseling. I am only exposing us to see that we have anger management problem. So that those of us who are in this problem will seek help. And I have already even given solutions, self-help solution, by the 9 points that I have given. But over and above that, if the person has a problem, you may need to suggest to the person that let us go and see a counselor because it is affecting. That's why the Bible says that do not be unequally unyoked with what unbelievers. If you are yoked with somebody who is full of himself or herself, then we are in trouble. But the truth is that if the person is not ready to change, Shakespeare says, there's no one so deaf as he who refuses to hear. The person must be willing and must see that I need help. So this teaching that I am doing, for example, you can let your spouse or that person watch it. And I pray that the Holy Spirit may touch him or her. But the truth is that maybe you too are a cause. In Akan, we say that Bibi and Kokan Papa and Jekrede. So it is two-way thing. But the truth is that you can't take medicine for somebody. You have to convince the person to let the person know that you need the therapy and you can help the person. The next one I have here. Is there a question?
Good evening. Somebody online. Yeah, good evening, Father.
Good evening, my dear.
Please, my name is...
Your name? Did we lose him? Oh, sorry. If you are back, let me know. If you come back, let me know.
Yeah, hello.
Yes, speak, please.
Okay, so my name is Edwedu, calling from Achimota-Ola. My question is, if at a moment or at a point you are angry and you want to get over it, so you want to stay mute, so that after you are okay, you'll be able to voice out. Is it one of the best ways to manage anger? Because I didn't hear that one. Sometimes you want to stay calm so that you will not say things or do things that might hurt the other person until you are fully yourself. So what do you think about this?
We spoke about this in last week's session, and it's good that you have brought it up. When we dealt with what is anger, and we looked at a few things that, you know, when you are angry, the problem is that you need to be able to keep quiet and ask yourself, the reason why I am angry, is it really a reason? Is it what it is? So if you don't keep quiet like you are talking about right now, you may act and then regret it. So this is, if you look at the points in there, that is called the cognitive restructuring. In the cognitive restructuring, I am angry. Now, why am I angry? Because of the anger, I am hurt and I want to do something. Now, I have to think that, why am I angry? So I need time. I need relaxation. You see that one of the solutions is what? Relaxation and stress reduction techniques. So, and some of the relaxation is what? Keep quiet for a while. Take a walk. Go for jogging. Go and take your bath. Or count 1 to 10. Or just breathe in and breathe out. Breathe in and breathe out. Or go and watch a movie. Or just go and make a nice call. Or those things like that. So yes, sometimes you need to move away from the scenario, and then you are able to come. All these will form part of the relaxation and stress reduction techniques. So my brother, it is a very good point that you have brought up, and I share it totally with you. Yes. Any other person online? Somebody says, thank you, Father, for this wonderful and important teaching. I came a bit late. I would want to find out how will one know he or she has anger problems. Wow. Okay. We have said a lot about that. But one is that when people tell you that you have anger problem, you know that you have anger. Number, another thing is that when you see people are always tiptoeing at your back, they are coming to you and they are afraid. They are coming to you and they are afraid. You know that, hey, my brother, there's a problem. Or maybe you are always having rage in you or anger, that rage, and your body keeps shaking. You see your whole body. And
it's 21 hours. Rising.
You know that you have anger problems. So we have talked about some of them. I think you may have missed it during the session. So we did really talk about them. The next one is that, and if this anger is not helping the situation, what can I do differently? I don't know the first question that... I do not know the first question. Okay. Thanks, Father, for this one. Good. Thank you, too. Can you please explain techniques 1, 3, 4, and 9? Hey, 1, 3, 4, and 9 again. Wow. I think these are many, and it will take me to do all. But cognitive therapy is simply trying that you watch how you think. so that it will affect the way you feel, and the way you feel would affect what you do. Then you say 3, exposure therapy. Exposure is that you are exposed to something that does not exist. For example, you just look at a movie and you see somebody cheating the wife or somebody beating the child, and then you ask yourself, what will you do? What will you do in that situation? Then you are able to what? Expose yourself prior to the time. And when you are able to do that, you think, so next time a similar situation happens to you, your anger will be calmed down. Another one is what? You say number 4. Number 4 is journaling and thought record. That is that. What do you do? You write some of the things or the way you behave. You got angry and you broke a bottle. You got angry and you slapped your wife. You got angry and you insulted somebody. Write it down. Write it down. After 3 days, look at it. After 1 week, look. After 1 year, look at it. And then you see yourself. You see? And you say that, hey, is this where I am? Is this where I was doing? Then you begin to say that, no, I am a monster. I can't behave that way. So you see that you begin to change. Then I think you chose number 9. Number 9 too says that successive approximation. That means that all these things that I have talked about, can you do it once at once? No. You just take your time. Take one at a time. Just take one at a time and you are able. So make it bit by bit, bit by bit. Nobody cooks by making the food ready at once. We are not doing microwave food here. We take our time and then we get it. Is anybody on the line to ask a question?
Yes, yes.
Go on, please. Go on, please. If you're on the line, please give your question. Come up with your question, please. I think we have lost the person. Some people take it as you are being disrespectful or rude. Oh, boy. Please, anytime you are sending the question, make sure the question is complete, because I will not be able to go up to the first question. Sometimes it becomes difficult doing the sessions like that. So I'm not able to pick and join the questions as, yeah. Please, if I am angry and decide to be quiet because I want to control it and talk later, you said that too is not good. I didn't say it was not good. I said it was even good. I said it is good. Just that don't keep quiet and decide not to talk about it again. Afterwards, come back to the question. Because they say, he who fights and runs away lives to fight another day. Is anybody on the line? Somebody says, please, just to provide some further clarity. Okay, yes. Michael, if you're on the line, you'd like to provide clarity. Please, would you like to speak? Let us know. Then we would unmute you by showing your hand. Yes. Michael Anson. Yes. Thank you, Father, for this very important message. I am listening and watching from Asante Bekwai. Oh, God bless you and all the people in Asante Bekwai. Please, Father, I have a problem in having regrets about some of the decisions I have taken in the past, which did not help me. And I keep on regretting about them, especially when I see my friends having good lives. It always makes me regret more and more. My dear brother, my dear sister, the past is past. Let it be. You can do more about the future. Let your past be. And let us concentrate on the future. If you do that, you are a better. I see somebody on the line. Is there somebody on the line?
Hello, Father.
Yes, dear. Speak.
Okay. So it's about when you're angry, then you decide to keep quiet. Okay. So in those instances, some people don't take it lightly. It's either they are seeing you as you are being disrespectful or you are being rude just because you are not speaking. In that heat of the situation, you decide to keep quiet. But you explained earlier that it's also good to be quiet. But the instances where people take it otherwise, what should one do in such situation?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. You know that the silence can be another form of a way that people fight in marriage or relationship. You are talking to the person, and then all of a sudden, the person just goes quiet. I won't mind you. You see, the way you keep quiet, if you do it rudely, it will communicate wrongly. If you would ask and admit that, I think that I am hurt at this moment. Can you allow me, please, to just relax a little bit and come back to it? But all of a sudden, you take a flight of silence. So the way you apply the silence is what, it's not just they say we apply silence and then you are talking to a person and then all of a sudden you just go quiet like that. And then you just fold your arms and you are looking at him or her. Talk, have you finished? Yes. Okay. Then you just quiet. You are not answering with a face that no. You see, you haven't said much, but you have acted a lot, which may be full of anger and pride. So it's, that's why I'm saying that even if you have to be quiet, know how to do it and don't be quiet forever. Come back at appropriate times, because he who fights and runs away lives to fight another day. Okay? Is there any other person on the line? No person on the line. Father, can I share the method to manage my anger? Father, how can I? No, I don't get the question yet. Okay. Today we have been very long, but I think it is for this session. I don't know. Co-host or send me message. I think we can end here, but I do have a lot of questions. Someone just asked my question. Thank you. Oh, the person who asked the question, somebody's question. God bless you. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity and this great work and education. I learned anger is part of temperament. A choleric is one who is most angry and quick-tempered. So I want to ask, if anger is a temperament and everyone has temperament, is it a sin? Please, I have just told you that anger is part of life. God himself expresses anger. So let us not think that anger is a sin. But if you are angry, you must ask yourself, why are you angry? The reason why you are angry, is it justifiable? Is it a fact? Is it an assumption? Or is it a presumption? And if these things are taught right, then you see that immediately your feelings will begin to change. If you begin to know that it was a mere presumption, then you begin to say that, after all, you were standing on a rock that is not solid. So then you begin to give up like that. I want to thank everybody for coming on the line. Today, it has been very, very long. Oh boy, I have lots and lots of questions. I don't know whether, I think Michael wants to give a suggestion. So I'd read that since it's a suggestion. The words assume and presume both mean that you take something for granted as being true, but the difference is based on how certain you are. That is very true, Michael. Assume is typically used in a situation where someone takes something as truth with very low level of certainty. Very good, Michael. And with no proof at all. So when you are assuming, you just take things for granted. You just take things for granted that you assume that you think that I will not be angry. How do you know? Okay, now presume usually involves a higher level of certainty, and it is used in a situation where someone makes an educated guess based on a reasonable proofs or evidence. And sometimes some of these presumptions may be wrong. And some the things that we are calling educated or guess may be based on a false research, and the whole presumption will be wrong on them. So thank you, Michael, for that, such a brilliant expose on assumption and presumption. Thank you all for today. Shall we be quiet in a moment and we pray? But before we pray, remember, all of us, anger is in the soul part. If you don't take care of it, it affects your spirit. And not just your spirit, but your body too. So be careful of your anger. Shall we pray? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God, our Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, today you have taught us that we all have a weakness of anger that is poorly managed in our hearts. Holy Spirit, teach us that you will teach us the truth. Help us that we will not operate always in the flesh, that our thoughts and our actions will lead us into bad conclusions. Father, bless us, heal us, change and transform our minds, that our feelings and hurts will be transformed, and that our actions from today will be actions that will bring good as we avoid evil. For we make our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Very amen. Much, everybody.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Bless you all.